Okay, it is a particular pleasure for this keynote address to welcome John Ralston Saul. Those of you who attended an earlier meeting like this many years ago at the school may remember, John gave the keynote address at that time, and it was an inspiring talk about his view of business and economics. And I think we're absolutely delighted that he has accepted our invitation again to do that again today. John is probably, arguably, the leading philosopher, public policy observer, and commentator of the country. He has written for a long, long time on business issue, on economics issues from his perspective. In fact, 20 years ago, his book, Voltaire's Bastards, came out, where he first started to shine a light on business practices and economics practices. And just now, 20 years later, a new edition of that book is coming out, so I can only recommend to you, if you haven't looked at the first time around and read it, you have another chance to do it now. So it is it's a wonderful opportunity for him to pick up on some of the themes that I think he has raised at that time and respond to what he heard at the meeting today. In his day job, John is president of Penn International and has a very broad perspective from that as well about the international community and their feeling about what we do and what educators do around the world. So, John, thank you very much for joining us again. The floor is yours.
Oops. Thank you very much. It's amazing that you would have me back after what I said last time, but I'm thrilled to be here. And I'm above all thrilled to be here to celebrate Roger, who's done so many amazing things and keeps saying new things, which is so important. And I'm glad I was able to hear you last night, because it helped me very much think about what to talk about today. So just two introductory comments. The first is, I go straight from here. I'm literally going straight to the airport to fly to France, where my wife and I have a small business. I could do with your advice, because we lose money. We have 325 olive trees, which produce very, very high quality olive oil. And it's quite interesting, because there's a surplus of olive oil in the world, and we actually purposely produce virtually wild olive oil. And it's not simply cold-pressed virgin, as Santiago probably knows. That's a phrase under which there are many, many types and approaches and machines. We actually produce ours using basically medieval methodology pushed by electricity, so that it takes three times longer than 95% of the cold-pressed virgin olive oil that you buy. So it's quite interesting. It's a choice to go slower and to sell it for quite a $52 a half liter in Toronto, you know, because it actually is a lot more work to do it that way, and it's a response to a surplus situation. If we lose money, it's because we should either have 100 trees or 1,000 trees, and then we have 325. It's just the wrong amount of trees, in my opinion. Anyway, the point of the story is that I'm going to a world where I'll be surrounded by farmers who actually are living a very different world from the world thought about in this room or in these business schools. And then I'm going to fly straight from there to South Africa, partly for my books, but partly to be part of a sort of think tank with 200 thinkers about the situation in South Africa. Again, nothing whatsoever to do with economics or thoughts that would come out of these sorts of schools, but in fact really about a society divided by the lack of education and the lack of security, both of which you would need in order to get the economics going. And from there I fly for Penn to Moscow, which is a city which has one quality, if you could call it that, which is there are probably more senior businessmen in jail in Russia than in any other country, perhaps for the wrong reasons, but they are in jail. And there it's, again, a country where the principal problem is not economics or business methodology. The principal problem is rule of law. Completely different situation. I'll be there because a lot of our members of Penn have been shot, have been killed, have been beaten up or under threat, and we're trying to figure out what we can do to back up our colleagues there. And, of course, then I'll be coming back to Toronto, which is a fourth case where the most interesting thing about the city, in spite of what you might think today, is, you know, you just look out here and you have a city which is the only city in the world which really has a population of, I don't know, 6 to 8 million, depending on where you draw the line. So it's a major city where over 50% of the population were born outside of Canada. It's the only city in the world, major city in the world, that can say that. And what's the thing that makes the city work isn't business or business methodology, although it's always essential. What makes the city work and function and prosper and do well is this very peculiar decision that was made at a certain point somewhere in the early 60s that instead of being a prejudiced, narrow-minded Northern Irish Protestant city, frightened of difference, rather the way many European countries are frightened of difference today, that we would actually decide that it was fun and that we would enjoy being confused on a permanent basis. And that became the strength of the city, this permanent uncertainty, confusion, not knowing, and people just enjoying doing it together. And one of your colleagues who's here and I were at a wonderful gathering just a couple of nights ago of a new, what is it called, the Arab Institute, which is an attempt to bring together all Arabs in Toronto to work on issues that might relate to them. It was an astonishing gathering of the professional community of Toronto Arabs with the professional community of non-Arabs in Toronto. And there was about 500 people there. And it was a sort of elite illustration of how Torontonians are trying to figure out how to run a city in a different kind of way. I thought it was a very moving and very successful thing. So the point of this little introduction is there's four examples of four places where the principal driving forces are completely different. They are not driven by globalization, principally. They are not driven by similar problems or needs. Actually, they're very, very local and very different. Does that mean they don't have any relationships possible between them? No. Does that mean that business schools don't have a role to play? No. But I do remember sitting in, I think, one of the what was supposed to be the finest business school in South Africa, you'll have to tell me which one it was, for a day where we were talking about things, and after something like 5 hours, I said, you know, this has been fascinating. I could be in Toronto. I could be in New York. You haven't actually said a word about the reality of South Africa, which is violence, poverty, what's happening out there where the schools don't work. And there was the silence, and then they all said, you know, you're absolutely right. Why don't we spend the rest of the day talking about South Africa? In other words, this sort of sudden realization that the theory of the manager is a wonderful international global theory, but actually, what is the reality on the ground? How do places really function on the ground? What really happens on the ground? And they said, you know, we never talk about the fact that the schools have fallen apart and aren't functioning out in the countryside and how this leads to the violence. And we don't talk about that here. We're talking about an abstract theory of management which actually relates to a very small percentage of the leadership of the country. The first part of the introduction, the second part of the introduction, I really enjoyed. I enjoyed all the panels. I've really enjoyed the day. And I must say, I thought it was a much more exciting gathering than in 2006 when I was a little bit depressed because I felt that people were not facing up to what was happening. I thought today, I don't mean this to sound patronizing at all, but you know, if it does, forgive me. I thought today was interesting that people were grappling with the fact that things are changing. Something's got to be done. Things are being done. Is enough being done? What is being done? Some of it was defensive. Some of it was confused. Some of it was, let's just try stuff. Some of it was inspired. And so I've found it a very, very fascinating day. I mean, It is fascinating to think, 13,000 of these schools, how many students would that represent? There was a number, it went by too fast, I mean, an enormous number. 250,000 U.S. alone. And it may be that part of the problem is a slight problem of delusion. Delusional problems are big in success, right? I mean, which is to believe that the MBA is somehow at a high level and must be at a high level. It may simply be that when you have such a success and there are so many students in so many schools, that really all the business schools are and the MBAs are is the commerce schools of 1900, pumped up a bit. And that most people who are coming to them are the people who would have gone to the commerce schools in 1900. I mean, after all, if I say to you that for most professions today, a BA, in 1900 you needed grade 12 education, or baccalaureate. Right? You didn't need university education. And we've simply added another 4 years onto getting to the same place. Maybe we do it better, maybe we have more education, but it's fundamentally, grade 12 is 4 years of university today. Maybe MBA is commerce 1900. And if that's the case, I think that all the talk about going online, putting it online, is an interesting way of coming to terms with that and just saying, let's get the commerce stuff out of the way. Let's just make that easy, and then maybe we could see who can keep up with the interesting stuff and who just really wants the basic go out and do whatever in commerce, in business. But I think it has to be talked about, perhaps, in that way in order to get at what the problem is. Because the real point, it seems to me that the real points were in a sense being missed because in reality what we're talking about is the fact that over the last 50 to 60 years, the fundamental education of the ruling elite of the West in particular has shifted, and I'm going to come back to that, has shifted from other faculties to this faculty. This is the faculty which produces the ruling elite, according to the way in which people think, what people pay, the way money is generated, and so on. And if that's the case, then one has to be very conscious that what's going on here is not actually, even if you are looking for vice presidents for, I don't know, what used to be Woolworths or whatever, or a high-tech company or a bank, that in reality what you're really also doing is educating the people who are being pushed into, theoretically, a great deal of the most powerful positions in the world. So that's a different kind of responsibility that comes with the success, the incredible success that Roger talked about, that the last panel talked about. And I think the other little element that I would add to that is that this sort of education was put in place in the late 19th century. And I repeat this endlessly, so if any of you have heard me say it, but it's one of those things you have to keep repeating. According to the international reinsurance industry, average life expectancy in the West in 1900 was 50. With all the reasons of women dying in childbirth, whatever. Was 50. And the concept of this sort of education was invented, in 1870s? And when life expectancy was 50, approximately. Life expectancy now is about 80, and for your students, it's 90 to 100. We've virtually done, the biggest revolution of the 20th century was we virtually doubled life expectancy. Never been done before in history. In the Roman Empire, life expectancy was 28, unless you were a gladiator, in which case it was 29. Because gladiators were the sports heroes of the day and very, very well looked after, and very few died. Who does these numbers? I have no idea, but they're apparently respectable numbers. And so that whole interesting idea of how you do education, at what age do you do education, how long does education last? A number of people were talking about this. Why should it be 1 year? Why should it be 2 years? To which I say, absolutely. Why are we trying to force people through faster? Why are we trying to hold on to structures which were put in place at a time when life expectancy was 50? It makes absolutely the biggest failure probably of Western civilization today is the inability to come to terms with our successes And this is an astonishing success. What are these people going to do with the extra 40 years of their lives? We have no idea. We're sending them on cruise ships, right? We're happy that we have empty palaces and empty cathedrals to march them through, because we have absolutely no idea what to do with them. It's a failure of the imagination of Western civilization. It's a failure of the business schools. It's a failure of the business community. It's a failure of the politicians, to say nothing of the philosophers. So I think that when you sort of talk about all of this, I think you have to have in your minds these kids at some collective unconscious level know that you're misleading them. You're misleading them because they're going to live to be 90 or 100, and nothing that you're teaching them or opening up to them is really helping them think about the arc of their lives in this society. In fact, what we're busily doing is making it harder and harder for them to imagine how they might do 90 years. And the last introductory comment is just in case you didn't know, but it is actually related. I don't know, who does know, but this building, which you may love or hate, the library, was in fact the building which inspired Umberto Eco to write The Name of the Rose. I don't know how many of you knew that. You knew it. Anybody else? No. Because, of course, it is, you know, a defended bastion. I mean, it's a real image of a time. A defended bastion in which you can't, it's hard to get in and hard to get out unless they want you to. And that's what gave him the idea. Anyway, it's an irrelevant point, but I thought I'd mention it on the way by since I have it behind me. If you're not leaving tonight and you have time, I would encourage you to go just down the street on Bloor to the Royal Ontario Museum, where in the basement there's an astonishing show on Mesopotamia. I don't know if any of you have seen it, the Torontonians. And it isn't, they borrowed from all the key places except Iraq, which they can't get the stuff out of, in Syria. And what's fascinating about it for you is that the man who's put it together, who's a German trained in the States and he's now in Toronto, is a very convincing arguer of the fact that bureaucracy, to say management, and writing were invented at the same time in a related process in the Tigris-Euphrates 6,000 years ago. And he has, it's interesting to go and see it from the point of view of teaching what you teach. And at almost the same time, of course, you get the production of the Gilgamesh myth, which is the beginning of modern storytelling, of the idea of mortality, the idea of society, the idea of how are we going, the question of how we're all going to live together. And it all comes together in this very interesting exhibition. But what I think is fascinating is that as you're struggling with what is a business school, I stand here as having written Voltaire's Bastards in 1993, which was considered to be totally outrageous at the time, and now I listen today, and it sounds actually quite mainstream in some ways, given what some of you are saying, that really this concept of managerial dominance in a society, of form and method over content, has a long history, 6,000 years. And if teaching the kids doesn't bring with it an understanding of those 6,000 years, then you're shoving them out into whatever the world is with a terrible misunderstanding about what is possible and what might happen. We know an enormous amount about what happens when states go deeply into debt, about what happens to corporations, about what happens in growth, about what happens with technology. We've got thousands and thousands of years of experience, all very carefully documented. We know how things go wrong. Just, you know, a little earlier when, who was it who was talking about Motorola? It was Patrick, and I said, that sounds like BlackBerry, right? But I could actually take you back through the centuries with those same images. So if we're actually teaching in a way that doesn't give them a sense that this has happened many times before, that what's changing may be speed, may be size, it may be the technology, but actually the process, what the up and the down, the way things succeed, the way things fail, people have been doing this for a very long time, and we know how to describe all of that. I mean, that's why Adrian kept coming back to the question of the importance of history. It's not an English romantic idea of the importance of history. You know, it is actually an element of it. And I think the other thing which is slightly missing in the descriptions is the constant references to, you know, globalization and the global, as if it were all brand new. It's so boring. It's so untrue. It isn't real about the way in which the world functions. And anybody who studied the reign of the five emperors, the British, the French, the German, the American, and the Italian, yeah, because the Spanish was finished, sorry. And, you know, for about 100 to 150 years, knows that those empires controlled the world in an agreement among themselves. They didn't actually fight very much over those 150 years. They controlled the world in a global methodology, far more sophisticated than anything that's happening today. They actually had their hands on movement, on trade. They knew exactly where they were going and what they were doing once they decided where the borders lay. Was it just? I'm not talking about justice. I'm talking about methodology. But when one hears this sort of discourse about globalization today, as if it were the first time, I mean, Keynes is very, very eloquent on all of that in his famous book, written shortly after he resigned from the British delegation at the Versailles negotiation in 1919. He wrote a quick hot book, which became a bestseller as to why Keynes had resigned, in which he said this is all going to lead to the Second World War, I mean, more or less. And the reason it's going to lead to the Second World War was, and then he described the past, and in describing the past, he described how the empires had run the world and how, in a way, what we've gained because of technology is we've moved from buying and selling shares in 2 hours to buying and selling them in 2 seconds. I mean, is that actually as important as moving from, Renaissance painting to Picasso? I doubt it very much. We've won a couple of hours. We've done some interesting things. But those empires, for better or worse, had a concept of the global, which I don't think is being taken into account in the discussions that really go on. So I think that the real challenge today is the thing I mentioned right at the beginning, which is that we are, in effect, there is always an elite. There is always an elite structure. Stalin or Hitler or the democracies, there's always an elite structure. And what is fascinating about this era, the last 50, 60 years, has been the rise of managerialism within the elite structure to the first position. And that managerialism has largely been driven by what I would call either rational utilitarianism or utilitarian rationalism. I'm not quite sure which is the right way to say it. And the problem lies there. And the problem that a lot of you were addressing today about critical thinking, imagination, design, was all about how do we get management out of rational utilitarianism, which is where it was born. It was not born in imagination. That's the problem. And it's very difficult to take something whose fundamental roots were not in imagination, even if capitalism was in imagination, the business schools were not, to take it and bring it into another place. But it is essential to just say, look, there was a time when the structures for running society were military. There was a time when they were church. They were priests. They were the Jesuits, one of the most sophisticated managerial groups in the history of the world, right? And still are, in effect, but they're not the dominant group. And then from the middle of the 19th century to the middle of the 20th century, it was the lawyers in the West were the dominant managerial or not, the dominant elite group. They structured the society. They convinced society that it could be put together through the rule of law, which parliaments, legislatures were all about the rule of law. And then suddenly we're into this new era where all those things still exist, the military, the church experts, the legal experts all still exist, but the dominant players are the managers. There's no question about that. You look at the numbers, you look at how the decisions are made, whether they're business managers or government managers, it doesn't matter because the business schools are only a small part of the managerial structure, which again is another thing which really wasn't mentioned today. Which is, what all the things that you're saying are also being discussed or should be being discussed at Sciences Po in Paris, at LENA in Paris, at the Kennedy School, and so on and so on and so on. And there are many forms of those non-business managerial schools. And so when Sally Blunt, and I know Sally's still here. No. When she said that society had put great value on business education, I would actually disagree with that. Yes, society has put great value on business education, but business education and business put a lot of money and muscle into moving, Roger would agree with me, into moving business education up to the top. I mean, it was part of a process. It wasn't something that was popularly called for in elections. It was a drive which most universities didn't even see coming, in which financial budgets switched around, priorities switched around. It's not something which one could attribute to democracy. Doesn't mean it's bad. I'm just saying it's something that happened, and a great deal of work went into making it happen. The thing about elites is that in order for them to be successful, they have to do two things, only about two things. They have to function. Functioning means you actually have to deliver the goods. Deliver the goods. That's what an elite does in a democracy or in a dictatorship. And the second thing, which is relates more to a democracy but also a dictatorship, is they have to relate to society. They have to have a working relationship with society. You know? Otherwise, they're an isolated elite. They're the French aristocracy in the late 18th century, you know? Or the Russian aristocracy in the early 20th century. And those, I guess, are the what I think are the really interesting questions you kept saying today, that we have to reach out to the rest of the university. And I would say, hey, there's a much bigger problem. The real problem is, how do the MBAs reach out to society? How do the MBAs reach out to democracy? How do the MBAs deal with the ideas of social justice? Now that you are the dominant elite, it isn't good enough to say we're producing people to run banks or to run corporations. You're no longer in that kind of position. When the military were in charge, it wasn't good enough then to say, well, we're going to go out and win a war. As soon as you won the war, you had to come home and deal with the poverty-stricken peasants and, you know, the fact that the crops had been burnt and so on. I mean, that's what comes with authority and power. And that, so it's both that ability to deliver and that relationship to society. And I think it's not happening. It's a real problem. And I'll give you two quick examples. The other night, the Rémiards, I don't know, the Canadians here know, Gilles Rémiard has a very interesting gathering that happens in Montreal once a year. Now it's happening in Toronto as well. And at the opening this year, they had a conversation between Trichet, the former head of the European Bank, and the new governor of the Bank of Canada. And I both had private conversations. I know one of them, I know the other one vaguely, had private conversations, and I listened to what they were saying. And Trichet was his classic sort of marginally optimistic, because he's smart enough not to go too far in public, and very dry and quite careful. Behind that, you feel a fear of immigrants. Just off the page, off the financial page, you know, classic kind of 19th century fear of immigrants. And the new governor of the Bank of Canada sort of joked his way through it, which frankly was quite embarrassing. And he was relentlessly optimistic, which is an extremely dangerous position for a state banker, because if you're wrong, you look like a fool. And they limited their conversation to sort of how they'd worked their way out of the crisis and how trade was the answer. Well, trade as the answer is so old-fashioned, and it hasn't produced growth. I mean, there's lots more trade, and I'm in favor of trade, but it has not produced the growth that was expected for various reasons. But what was fascinating about it was that there was absolutely no hint in their discussion of responsibility. Now, I actually think that the state bankers did a fantastic job, because the governments, over a 20-year period, walked away from how to manage international crises. And I wrote about in this book that you've been given how the state bankers secretly, in effect, at their annual meetings, planned, created committees that could step in when the crisis came, because they believed the crisis was coming. And I wrote this book because in 1999 I was in Australia and I saw the then head of the state bank, who was a conservative called McIntyre, I believe, or McIntosh, and he said to me off the record, which I he's no longer there. I can quote him. He said, you know, this whole thing is just going to collapse through the tubes. It's going down through the tubes. It's finished. It's a disaster. And we're trying to prepare ourselves to handle it as best we can. The trouble is the Americans and the British are unwilling to cooperate because they believe there isn't a problem. You know, I think that's pretty straightforward. And, you know, and that's the days when Alan Greenspan was considered to be an intellectual. You know, and it's actually a very interesting thing because it tells you something about the obligation of the business schools and the economics departments to ensure that there is not a happy atmosphere of agreement around mediocrity. You know, because clearly when you look back on this guy, Alan Greenspan, you see a man who had no culture. You know, his favorite novelist was this sort of second-rate, if not third-rate novelist. That was the extent of his culture, really. And he had no real idea. He didn't seem to know history. He didn't seem to know how societies had worked in the past. He didn't seem to know what crises looked like. He was just a sort of mediocre guy who everybody thought, well, everything's going okay. It'll be fine with Alan there. And, of course, when the crisis came, he was no longer there, but he sort of said, I still don't understand what happened. I'm not surprised. I'm not even surprised that he was foolish enough to admit that he didn't know what had happened. But the point is that in this conversation I heard, there was no hint of the idea of responsibility and to the population, relationship to the population, employment, people's lives. They were just talking about, well, you know, we did this and that got that down and if that did that to the debt and this will do this. Turning their backs completely on the reality of what's happening out there, which will come back and have an effect, for example, on business schools, and I think is already in the kind of inquietude, the worry that you are expressing, is part of the pushback from the population, in a way. And I talked to one of them, I won't say which, just to be discreet, and we were talking about this, and he said, oh, it's all cyclical. It's all cyclical. And I said, yeah, the Second World War was cyclical. And he looked at me, and we walked away. You know, everything is cyclical. Yeah, yeah, 100 million people killed in the 20th century is cyclical. It's also failure and a failure of the elites. And the second one is Santiago and I were having a great conversation last night about Spain. And we chatted again about it today. And we had two conversations. The first one was about the economic catastrophe in Spain, the austerity, the restructuring, the numbers are slowly coming around. It might even move very, you'll tell me if I'm saying this wrong, very, very slowly towards very small bits of growth, technically probably going to satisfy the people who are putting the screws on Spain, right? And then we had a completely separate conversation, which was about 55% youth unemployment, which is actually probably really worse, which includes many young people doing minutia jobs for poverty wages. They're probably two lost generations. So black market, people leaving in enormous, which is 250,000, you said, have left Spain for elsewhere. A mediocre government. Now, this is my opinion. I'm not quoting him. Mediocre government, mired in deeply in corruption, the rise of populism, and in effect, what historically would be called a pre-revolutionary situation. It doesn't look like it in the streets. Again, a very curious thing. But if you look at the numbers, pre-revolutionary, and on top of that, the slow recovery is not producing jobs, which, of course, is common to the recovery taking place around the world today. So the fact that, in a way, we couldn't have the one conversation, we had to have two conversations, is probably true of virtually every country. That we have a kind of elite structure which is looking at economics and management in one context, completely unrelated or largely unrelated to the reality of the civilization in which they're operating. And the subject is avoided by talking about globalization. It's always somewhere else. We're always on the move. Something is happening at the international level. No, actually, 1.7 million Canadians are using food banks, of which 12.5% have jobs. And one-third are children. And the numbers, I just looked up the numbers in the United States because I knew there'd be Americans here just to check. They're identical. We're still at the old 10% rule. They're virtually identical. That's related. It's directly related to design. It's directly related to the qualities of the graduates of business schools who are going out and are playing the central role in where the economy is going, and therefore, in whether or not there will be 1.7 million people using food banks in a middle-class country when before globalization there were none. We had to set up the food banks early in the days of globalization, the first crisis of globalization, and we thought, as did people in other countries, this would last 6 months. Today they're major installed institutions. So I think that you could say that we're in a period of an elite crisis, and this elite crisis comes at a time when the managers are in charge. So, you know, I know people say, how much are we responsible for what's going wrong out there? I'm putting this differently. I'm saying we're in a crisis. It's a major crisis. We are not recovering in any serious, profound way, and the managers are in charge. That's all. It's something we have to talk about, you have to talk about. That's part of the larger consequences of being the most important elite in certainly the Western democracies. And there are consequences to failure. There are consequences to societal failure. We don't know what they will be. We don't know. Is Spain in a pre-revolutionary state? Is Greece? How far can you go in a country that doesn't have oil, gas, and everything else under the ground like Canada? How far can you go without things breaking down? I know Europe pretty well. I spend a lot of time there. I can count, you know, when 19th century ugly nationalism started to reappear, you know, in the late 90s. You can just see it, and then the forms that it started to take, and then the appearance of populism, and then the appearance of racism, and then, most interesting of all, the conversion of racism into acceptable public discourse, which started happening after about 2003 or 4, getting more and more respectable to be a racist. You just can't quite use the old language. You've got slightly different messages sent, but it's clear it's racism. And it's clear it's making its way more and more into the center of major political parties. So all of this is actually happening. It doesn't feel like it in here. It doesn't feel like it in most places that people like us go, you know? But that's what's actually happening in the streets, in houses, in voting, and so on. The rise of populism, the rise of racism, and a kind of dismissal of politicians, which actually means a dismissal of the concept of democracy, which is incredibly problematic for all of us. So the Rob Ford joke actually is not really a joke. It actually is the sign of a real failure. The stable support that he has, and I mean foreigners can get this, the stable support that he has in spite of everything that's self-evident about the man, should suggest there is no reason for him to have any support at all, and yet his support is stable. So what people like us do is we sort of talk about it in a rather dismissive way, contemptuous way, and so on. But in fact, that support that he has is a direct comment on me and on you. It is a comment by the population on their lack of confidence in us. And I could find you examples in virtually every one of the Western democracies of the same sort of thing. It's just Ford is the flavor of the day, and he's particularly peculiar on the surface, to put it mildly. Here we are. We're still talking about globalization. It was mentioned by many, many people today, as if nothing has happened, as if nothing is happening, as if it was the justification for a belief, a kind of passive belief in international inevitable forces. And I think that's why it was so interesting to hear Sarah Beckman, I think, who was talking about critical thinking, people talking about intellectual rigor. But where does that come into this discussion about globalization? I mean, first of all, I mean, we're all tied to the university in one way or another. Words mean something. They're not just any old word. So internationalism has always existed. There are dozens and dozens of schools about things that are international that predate the current idea of globalization. You know, one of them was mentioned today about people going on the grand tour. That was one of the earlier examples of internationalism. I mentioned the empires. But there are dozens and dozens of forms of internationalism which have existed and which continue to exist, which have nothing to do with globalization, which is a specific term with a specific meaning. And if you don't use it that way, then what you're in effect doing is preventing yourself from having critical thoughts about the thing, globalization, which was introduced very specifically in the 1970s and came to power in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, put in place certain institutions, promised very specific things. There's a long list of things that if we do this, this will happen. If you do that, that will happen. You know, if you do this, nationalism will decline. If you do this, there will be more growth. If you do this, there will be a larger middle class and a smaller group of poor people around the world. A whole bunch of things. And you, in order to be intellectuals, one has to say globalization is, it has the right to modify itself, to mutate. But it doesn't have the right to say that every time a kid gets on an airplane and flies somewhere, that's a sign of globalization. That isn't. That's some sort of element of internationalism which may or may not be related, but is probably unrelated to globalization. It may be related to technology. It may, in fact, if it's related to anything structural, be related to Keynesianism and the wealth produced and the technology begun in the 1950s, 40s, 50s, and 60s. I mean, if you're going to make that kind of argument. You could also argue probably that the kids getting on airplanes is an attempt to escape the concepts of globalization by walking away in a certain sense. So, what I call upon you to do is really think very carefully when you use these words about what they mean and what you actually intend them to mean so that you can keep your critical faculties. I think that if you look at the principal movements in the world since, let's say, 2000, which is the year when I would say we went into a kind of a vacuum, political and economic vacuum, is the principal movements have been regionalism, not globalization, regionalism. That's what's been growing over the last 10 to 15 years. The return of 19th century nationalism, astonishing return, which was supposed to be finished and over with, very powerful and getting stronger every day. The incredibly surprising return of the ugliest forms of populism. There's some actually nice populism as well, but mainly it's really ugly populism getting stronger all over the place and being integrated into mainstream discourse. And the rise of anti-democratic movements. And then in pure economic terms, I would say the most fascinating thing of the last 10 to 12 years has been the move away from capitalism towards mercantilism. In other words, full circle back to a pre-capitalist period in which what people on the left will call things like, you know, the transnationals and those big corporations, and they sort of demonize them in capitalist terms, as opposed to, because they don't know their history, as opposed to saying, that looks awfully like the British East India Company in terms of its linear, flat, integrated methodology from, you know, the silkworm to the silk curtain sort of thing, where wealth is not created because one corporation owns or can control the process, so there isn't a proper buying and selling process around the world. What caused this? I mean, I have a theory, which is that we're in surplus of goods and not in scarcity of goods, and that therefore the capitalist model doesn't actually work very well. It drives down prices. So there are a couple of ways out. One of the ways was to go back to mercantilism. But you see, once you start saying, well, those are the really important things happening, then you have to say, well, is this what the business schools are dealing with? Are you really dealing with capitalism mutating back into mercantilism to a great part? Rogers Cage, and I agree with him 100%, just to put myself on the line here. Some people said they didn't. And I talked about this in Voltaire's Bastards and in some of my other books. I think that the problem of specialization is gigantic. Again, the problem of specialization doesn't take into account that thing I mentioned at the beginning, which is the doubling of life expectancy. If we've got twice as much time, we've got a lot of time. There is absolutely no reason to say things are more complicated, so people must move into narrow and narrow specializations. In reality, there's lots of time for people to be specialists and generalists. I mean, that's part of rethinking what education should look like in order to fill properly the arc of living for 90 years. And that's something that needs to be, I think, discussed very seriously. And yet, you look at the crisis of 2008, which in my view was only the crisis actually began in 73, and we diverted it with all sorts of things, and it came back out in 2008. But you look at that crisis and you say, well, that ought to have shocked them. That's what the population are thinking. The people who decide on whether they will pay taxes to support public universities, you know? That ought to have shocked those guys, even if you're girls, those guys into action, into change, into doing something about my kid who's not going to have a job, and my kid who's going to have three jobs, and I and my husband have two jobs each, and none of them are secured. And instead of that, we've seen almost no change in the departments of economics. They're still teaching the same stuff that brought the crisis on. All over the world, it's astonishing. They absolutely refuse, with a few exceptions, to take into account what it looks like on the ground, what it actually looks like. There has not been, I mean, has there been a radical change in the economics departments in Spain? No, no. I mean, how is it possible you can have 55% youth unemployment and they're pumping out kids with BAs in economics using the theories that brought it on? How is it possible? How can we expect people to continue to support tenure and the universities, if we're not paying attention to what is actually happening in the real world? So, you know, even the military, after the disaster of the First World War, the lieutenant colonels and the majors, the lieutenant colonels and the full colonels, used that short period of time to completely reform the way in which they would do war, for better or worse. But they did actually pay attention to the fact that there had been a disaster. And I don't think that I see enough signs of that. I think the conversation today showed that the business schools are thinking a lot about things, but actually there isn't that much time. I think it's quite urgent. In many ways, if you're guessing historically, today is a bit like being in the middle of the 18th century, a very large, very sophisticated elite out of touch with where society is and society is going, or it's a bit like the early to mid-19th century, the Metternich era. Those are the two areas that come to mind when I think about where we are today. The great sophistication of an elite which is failing. And I'm part of it, so we're failing. We're not doing our job. And it's whatever it is, I have no idea what it is, it's looming up on us. So what I'm saying is that globalization as defined in the 1970s, 80s, and 90s became dominant. It was basically supported by the departments of economics and the business schools. It became part of their discourse as to how the world would work. The governments and the populations followed. It reached its probably high point structurally in terms of power methods and all the rest of it in 1995 with WTO, and then it went into a decline. You can analyze the decline. I talk about it in the book. By 2000, it really wasn't functioning at all, although the elite insisted on pretending it was. We then went into a vacuum. People like me said, you know, you've got 5 to 10 years to get your act together because something is going to hit. When you move into a vacuum, when it's no longer functioning, whatever you think is supposed to function, the church, whatever, you've got a few years to get your act together and come up with a new theory of how to run things. We did nothing. We were in total denial. The thing hit us. And now we're failing to respond. And on top of failing to respond, we're in a completely defensive mode because we lost the opportunity to respond by using critical thinking. So now we're on the defensive. And the solutions still aren't related to reality. We've taken something like debt and attached religious morality to it, to the payment of debt. I mean, this is the most astonishing thing for an elite, theoretical, analytical elite of guys, to actually decide that one of the most important theories of our day is that there is a moral obligation to pay your debts in the public sector. And if you're an individual citizen, not if you're in a corporation. This is really amazing. And that we would actually organize our response to this crisis on the basis that there was a moral obligation to pay debts, thereby getting us deeper and deeper into the crisis. We then started pushing the theories of austerity. In 2,000 years, there isn't a single example that I know of a society getting itself out of a crisis through austerity. It has no track record. The only thing austerity can do is when you have runaway inflation, you can do a really like a 6 months or something like that to try and stop it. It is not, has never been, there is no proof that austerity leads anywhere. And yet, there we are doing it, which shows the kind of confusion. And we're still stuck in these old arguments about growth, trade, and talking about technology as if somehow technology were in charge, which is a form of passivity, if you like. And what I feel, and maybe I'm wrong, but I am out there a lot, and I do feel that the population are pulling away. They're pulling away from the elites. They're getting angrier. They're trying to figure out. It's very hard when you're millions and millions of people to figure out how to say it and what to do. You know, you don't have the power. In a country like this, you get to vote periodically, and then how you get to vote and who you get to vote for. And it's a very awkward system. So crises are the toughest thing for democracies in particular. And yet, we are trying to ignore the fact that the populations are pulling away. And in our conversations among ourselves, we are careful not to talk about them. We don't talk about them. We don't talk about the 55% or whatever the percentages are, or the families where they're, you know, they've lost their security, or the mother and the father each have two jobs. We talk about other things, about the good job that we're doing. And just a simple example, I think, of how we sort of deceive ourselves is the way we've talked about China and globalization over the last 30 years. You know, I just have endlessly heard my friends in the West talking about, well, you know, globalization's working. China's coming in. China's doing this in globalization. China's doing that in globalization. I go to China. I'm sure many of you do. Nobody in China ever talks about globalization. It's a completely Western idea. They don't see it that way at all. They see themselves in completely 19th century national terms based on geography, and they need some stuff, and they want to sell some stuff, and they want to control some stuff. In order to control some stuff, they buy things. It's a very 19th century classic nation state, big nation state view of how you run things, how you run yourself. They were never promising or that they would engage in globalization in any way that was being described in our universities. And now we're sort of slightly surprised about it. I don't really know why, because they were always perfectly clear. We simply were not listening. So I think that what we're faced with, what you're faced with today when you're teaching these kids and they're going to go out, is you're faced with largely the failure of the globalist model as announced in the 1970s, put in place in the 80s and the 90s. It has not delivered largely. There are some good stories in there, but largely has not delivered on what it said it would do. It hasn't delivered on growth. It hasn't had a discussion about surplus goods versus the scarcity of goods, which I think is central to the problem, the price problems we have today and the rise of the idea that goods need to be cheap, that this is value in and of itself, when we know full well that the cheaper goods are, the more impossible it is for us to employ people in a middle-class manner. So it's a suicidal activity for middle-class democracies to be engaged in. And we're not having discussions about why is this happening? This is happening because there are too many goods. Well, what do you do when there are too many goods? What is the answer of the elite structure? More goods and trade, and more trade. And then if someone like me says, well, actually, I'm not against trade, but I don't actually see how these trade deals are going to make us richer, people say, oh, you're against free trade. I said, no, I didn't say I was against free trade. I'm an author. I make my living out of free trade. Or not free, but out of trade. I believe in trade. I'm saying there are too many goods, and that's driving the prices down, and we haven't come up with a way around it. I mean, I have, although I'm losing money at it, which is to produce very expensive olive oil. Less of it, more expensive. And which would allow me, if it were working, to pay myself more. So it's a good middle-class model. It's just I don't have enough trees. And we're not asking ourselves real questions about the social structures, and we're not asking ourselves a very fundamental question every time we throw off this term, globalization, which is people actually live somewhere. Margaret Thatcher was 100% wrong. Societies do exist. People live somewhere. I may not. I may be on an airplane 50, 60% of the time. You may not. You may be on an airplane 50, 60% of the time. You belong to the elite. But 95% of the population lives somewhere. They have to make their living somewhere. Some of them may be able to move to some extent. But basically, not only do they live somewhere, but they want to live somewhere. They feel they belong somewhere. And as long as one keeps slipping by that reality by using these sort of terms of globalization, we're missing the reality of what is happening to people. And I think that the importance of your role lies in coming to terms with much of that. Take a small example. You all know about the recent scandals of the American government, surveillance on all its friends, and then Canadian government on the Brazilians, I believe. But of course, everybody's doing it. I mean, the reality is gradually it will come out. The people who are better at lying and hiding things will disguise it. I mean, the French and the British will do quite well at disguising things because they're much more professional in these things. But the fact is everyone's... But what's interesting about it, this has happened because of technology, and it has allowed governments and the private sector to break a large number of the fundamental laws which protect the individual rights and the freedom of expression of citizens in Western society. They've shredded 150 years of incredible effort to put in place protections for citizens' rights. So surveillance is a dramatic example of the decline of law and the rule of law, the inability of law to enforce itself, replaced by the dominance of managerialism, which is essentially, don't take this badly, amoral. You have to put morality or ethics into it, as you were saying, by teaching it, by making it part of the way you do things. Essentially an amoral methodology and structure. And so that in fact, when it starts coming out that this is happening, there doesn't seem to be a belief that the legal structures can strike back and protect citizens. I believe in about 10 years, various Supreme Courts will, in fact, rule against the governments. But by then, we'll be so far into another era. But it is essentially a good example of how the times have changed. That's a pessimistic statement. An even more pessimistic statement is that the business schools got us all to transform the universities to put the business schools in the driver's seat to some extent or to a great extent. So that the universal concept of the universities, 19th century, 18th century concepts, were changed. And that's okay. Well, that happens. Change to promote the business schools. They're a source of funding. They became the thing that kids had to do. Instead of becoming a lawyer, you had to become a manager. Or instead of becoming an army officer, you had to become a manager. Instead of becoming a Jesuit, you had to become a manager. It became the new elite thing for kids to do, so it was logical that the business schools would restructure what was important in the universities, who was listened to in the universities. And the influence goes well beyond the business schools. As you say, it goes into the government schools, and it goes into the increasing encroachment of managerial concepts into philosophy, into history, into political science, into all of the other domains, so that these things are increasingly seen through a managerial light. Cooking, I mean, I don't know. You know, you go into art history. Half of art history today is managerialism, if you actually analyze it. So I guess the question that has to be asked is, if you have this enormous social responsibility, which I believe you have, and you believe that business schools are essentially about kids getting trained to get jobs in business, then we have a real problem. We have a really important social problem because, in fact, your influence is far greater than that. It has to be based on an understanding of society and understanding of civilization. If you don't believe that, then we have to seriously restructure the universities to get you out of the leadership role. I mean, there's a real choice there. It's a really important choice, and you have to think about what role you want to play in society with the 35 million or the 350 million or the, what is it in Europe now, 400 million? 400 million. What is the relationship you wish to have with the 400 million people in Europe? Because that's the real question if you're going to be a driving force in the universities. And I would apply the same judgment to Sciences Po or LENA or any of the other management schools. So I thought it was very interesting today that the first actual mention of entrepreneurship came in the last session on design. As far as I know, nobody else mentioned it until then. It's an interesting comment on state of mind, if you like. What it shows is that I think there's a problem, but it also shows that we're dealing with a far broader problem. subject here, that you yourselves know that we're dealing with something which is far bigger. You just haven't allowed yourselves to come to terms with the implications of what that is. I think there were all these interesting comments about change, the global network concept, the idea that individuals make changes in business, not organizations, the idea that the GMAT and the other entrance exams need methods should be changed. I think I totally support that idea. I think the way we choose kids to go into universities is very odd and very, very narrow, that history in the broadest sense has to play a much more important role, the history of management, the history of debt. I mean, I just wonder how many of those economists and how many business school kids, when they looked at this debt crisis from any position of influence, did they say to themselves, so what did Solon do in Greece, whatever it was, 2000, whatever, what did he do in Greece? After all, we all say that we are the civilization built on the glory of Greece, of Athens. The glory of Greece and Athens is entirely the construct of Solon, the greatest poet, coming to power in a debt situation very similar to the one that we were in, and deciding that the only way out was to write off the debts immediately. And it is the writing off of the debts and the rewriting of the legal code, doing away with the draconian code, which launched Athens into becoming the Athens we adore. And equally, probably, you know, one of the greatest governments in the, you know, the history of modern Europe was Henry IV and his Minister of Finance, Sully. You know, what did they do? They were, after a civil war, faced with a gigantic debt crisis just like this one. What did they do? They called the bankers in and they said, look, we got a problem. We can hang you. You can leave the country or we can negotiate. What would you like to do? So they paid them 10 cents on the dollar sort of thing. I can't remember exactly. The United States in the late 19th century, early 20th century, a series of defaults through collapse of the markets, which allowed the United States to not have to pay the money they owed the Europeans who had invested in the United States, but got to keep all the railroads, the infrastructure, and so on. Do the kids know this? Do they understand? Certainly, the people who ran, had the key positions in the United States didn't understand it, or in most of the other Western countries. There's been, in the reaction to the 2008 crisis, a terrifying lack of imagination at the top, a terrifying silence from the universities, and history suggests that there were lots of other options. I mean, for example, in the United States, probably the best thing would have been that the government just say, look, as of next Monday, every mortgage up to $300,000 is paid off. We don't care who you are. If you owe $400,000, you still owe $100,000. You would have got out of the crisis. You'd have saved the banks worth saving. You would have solidified the working class, the lower middle class, and the bottom half of the middle class. They would have been out of debt. The money would have gone into the banks. The banks worth saving would have been saved. And on top of that, they'd have been in a position to borrow again. It's not complicated. It's been done before, that kind of thing. But they thought it was more important to save the banks than to save the citizens. That's called an elite out of contact with the citizens, with reality. They simply didn't think that actually their primary obligation was to the citizens, and that because it was the real obligation, therefore there was a real solution which would have been good for the economy. They simply didn't think about it. That shows how isolated they were. So all of this to say, I often say when I'm talking in universities that I think that the department, not the most powerful, but in a way the department that has the most impact on how we begin thinking is philosophy. And the problem with philosophy in North America is that we haven't had an original thought here in 400 years, apparently, according to the way philosophy is taught. I mean, you're allowed a little bit of Dewey here and there, but in Canada, every philosopher we produce has to be shoved over to political science or communications because it's not possible that Marshall McLuhan could be a great philosopher or Harold Innes, so they have to be put somewhere else so that we can study Descartes. You know, that we can do footnotes on the European drawdown of what philosophy looks like. And so I keep saying, look, we need to blow up the philosophy department. Just blow it up. Get the people out. Blow it up. And then take all the pieces, a little bit of Kant, a little bit of Descartes, a little bit of Rousseau, whatever, a lot of Vico, I would say, and then say, what else should we put in here? Let's reorganize the way this is done. You know, if you're in Canada, I would put a lot of Indigenous philosophy in there, which is actually would get us into the right place in terms of the environment, in terms of communities. Really rethink the structure of our thinking. Why can't we do this for ourselves, right? And if we could redo philosophy, then we could probably redo economics and the business schools. So I thought one of the most encouraging things, and that's where I'll end, is that I heard today was there was a sort of sense that a lot of people wanted to see change. A lot of people felt that it's just become so big, so successful. Roger said this in the beginning, so successful. How can you change something so successful? Well, of course, you know, when the imperial armies march out, the grand imperial armies, filled with their own success, usually they're just about to be defeated by some little rabble who's invented something like a long bow and has some peasants with little daggers, and they're going to run under the French soldiers at Agincourt, horses, and kill the horses, and then the soldiers will fall down, and they're so magnificent they won't be able to get up, and then they'll slit their throats, which is roughly so specialized, so cut off from reality that when the disaster comes, incapable of responding to the disaster. So I think this is a very interesting moment to think. These meetings, right, maybe they need to be more often. Maybe you need to be thinking about a handful of schools that will say, okay, why don't we say we're going to break completely? We're going to sit down, we're going to spend 6 months, maybe shut them down for 6 months or leave a small group behind to run them for 6 months and say, let's redesign the business schools totally to do something else. To all these ideas I heard today, and if you sat down for 6 months, you'd come up, you know, like people writing constitutions or whatever. You'd say, have you thought of this? Why don't we do that? Why don't we do it this way? Why don't we change the entrance exams completely? And actually come up with a philosophically different approach, which would contain much of what you're doing today, but would go in another direction. And I think that would have a revolutionary impact on the way the other schools think. It would have a terrible and therefore positive impact on the economics departments, who need to be shaken up madly. It would surprise the universities completely. The smart government leaders would listen, and you would be playing your role as responsible elites. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much, John, for another really, really stimulating talk on what we are doing. I think we benefit greatly, actually, from being reminded that occasionally, at least, you have to take a wider lens and a wider perspective to what you're doing. So I thank you very much for doing that for us. We are close to the end of our day. I think we had a very useful discussion. Even John said we are marginally more reflective than we were. Much more. Okay. We had, I think, a good discussion. We touched on a number of issues that are close to our heart. And I think we had two bookends of presentations that really reminded us to take a step back, take a look at what we're doing, and take a look at what we're doing from a very distant perspective. So thank you very much to John and to Roger for doing that for us. Thank you very much to all of you for coming. Have a safe trip back, but before you go back, the bar is open next door. Okay.